Hey guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today I briefly want to talk about the futility of always pointing out an armor's weakness. So just a little explanation real quick. I'm hoping to do more frequent videos. And in addition to the videos that I already do, what I'd like to do is more videos in this kind of format where I just kind of share my thoughts or opinions on things. The other type of videos that I do require an incredible amount of research and time, production time and editing time to make them to the standard that I feel is good enough to put out. So because those are so much harder to do, I want to add more content to my channel in a format that's a little bit less formal, but still hopefully informative and usable to you guys. So I'm going to start that off today. And what I'd like to talk about today is kind of the trap that people fall into where it's real easy to see the one thing that armor doesn't do for you. And I want to explain why that's not really that constructive of a line of reasoning. So one thing that I'm always getting questions about or always getting comments on in my videos, regardless of the type of armor that I'm showing in that video, is the one thing that that armor doesn't do for you. So it's important to be aware of those things. But where we get into trouble is when we start to over-inflate the significance of that weakness to the point where we imply that it kind of negates the existence of the armor in the first place. What is the intent of armor? So in an ideal world, armor would make you completely invulnerable to the weapons that you're going to encounter on the battlefield, and it would still render you combat effective. Unfortunately, we don't live in that world, and the technology that's been available to us throughout human history, including right up until today, means that we are limited to forms of armor where we can significantly enhance survivability, but not to the point where it's completely rendering the person invulnerable. In order to use what we have available to us in ancient times and medieval times and in modern times, in order to make somebody completely invulnerable, we make them completely combat ineffective. We have not been able to figure out a way to make somebody completely safe while still enabling them to move, fight, see, hear, talk, do all the things that you need to be able to do. So inevitably, armor has weaknesses. Now, the things that always get pointed out are things like on my arm harness, the inside of my elbow is not protected. My legs, the back of my knee is not protected. The back of my thigh is not protected. My armpits are not protected. My groin is not protected. Are they really so unprotected? Well, most of those things, with the exception of the back of my thigh, and we'll talk about that separately, are protected by a layer of mail and additionally, usually, a layer of quilted textile padding. Now, we have the luxury as modern people to kind of look back over the entire timeline of the evolution of armor and see where armor is eventually going, because we have the spoilers. Because of that, we tend to look at mail as if it's a completely ineffective form of armor, and that's nonsense. It was a very effective form of armor for up to and including the 1,000 years leading up to the explosion of plate in the 14th century. And it stayed a very effective form of armor. You gotta remember, mail is still made of iron or steel, and it's worn over an additional layer of padding. That padding, in many cases, can function as a standalone armor without any of the metal bits on top of it. So, that additionally was very effective. It could resist sword cuts, arrow punctures, things like that. So now you're layering mail on top of it. And to negate the protectiveness of mail, sure, it's individually over a single part of the body, plate is considerably more effective than mail at resisting a lot of attacks. But to render male completely ineffective because we know how good plate is, it doesn't really make sense. So a lot of those particular areas that we look at are protected. They're just protected by a different form of armor that, in this case, the compromise, the need to be able to move the insides of those joints is important because the technology did not exist yet to protect those things with rigid steel plates. The other part of this is that those weaknesses are very well known to the person who's wearing the armor. So while mail is less effective, it can be penetrated. The person wearing that knows that as well. So consider that when you're fighting somebody, hitting them directly on the inside of the elbow or directly in the armpit is not that easy if they're standing perfectly still. And they're not standing perfectly still. They're fighting for their life just as hard as you are fighting for yours. They have the advantage of being intelligent combatants too. So they know that they're weak under the arms and inside the elbow and behind the knee. So they're going to do everything in their power to not present those targets to you. So not only are they small targets, they're small moving targets. They're small moving targets on an opponent who knows that they're targets and doesn't want to get hit in them. So they've trained in this armor. They know how to fight in this armor. They know that you know how to fight in your armor. And they know that you're hunting for those spots. So they're going to do everything in their power to minimize presentation of those targets. Things like the groin. The groin's going to get its own video because that one comes up a lot. So one, the groin is protected by mail and textile. But even so, it's still a vulnerability. Again, consider, people aren't standing there with their hands on their hips, staying perfectly still with their legs spread, ready to take a poleaxe shot to the nuts. They're doing everything they can to not let you hit them there. So it's not as easy as it kind of seems on the surface when you look back and just look at the armor in a very static way without imagining it being used on an actual living person who's fighting and is aware of those weaknesses. The thigh, the back of the thigh. So there are examples of fully enclosed cuisses. In fact, a lot of English armors seem to use fully enclosed cuisses because of their tactical preference for fighting on foot. But the overwhelming majority of late medieval cuisses are only protected on the front and often the outside of the thigh. So the back of the thigh and the inside of the thigh are not covered by plate. People love to see that and then point out, well, somebody can just go around you and stab you right in the back of the thigh. Yeah, they could. But again, how likely is that? And more importantly, even if that were a likely scenario, does it negate the existence of the rest of the cuisse? Is the disadvantage of having a little bit more weight, we're only talking a couple pounds here, of armor on your legs, so great that that disadvantage negates the entire protective value of the target that you're more likely to get hit in, which is the front of the leg and the outside of the leg, just by the nature of the type of warfare that was being conducted? No, it's much better to have a cuisse that only protects the front and outside of your thigh than to have no cuisse at all. So pointing out that there's an unlikely scenario where somebody can go around you and stab you in the back of the thigh, yes, you're right, it is a weakness. But it's not a weakness that negates the existence of the armor. The armor is still doing more for you than leaving you vulnerable. And that's what's most important here. So kind of an interesting example from fiction that really has nothing to do with history, but kind of is analogous to this scenario is Smaug, the dragon from The Hobbit, right? He had a pretty big vulnerability, well, physically a very small vulnerability, but a vulnerability that was important enough that it was fatal. The missing scale on his belly that Bard was able to exploit, get that black arrow into, and kill him. Does Smaug missing one scale on his belly negate the purpose of every other scale on his body, would Smaug have been better off if he had no protective scales on his body and an arrow could hit him anywhere and kill him? No. I think that's pretty obvious. So that's kind of an extreme and silly example, but it can be applied when thinking about the weaknesses in armor. So what it really all comes down to is context. Don't isolate, when you're examining a piece of armor, it's fine to note those weaknesses, because they are weaknesses, they are concerns. But don't isolate the armor from its intended use. That is to make you more survivable on the battlefield, to make you more combat effective. And in that context of actually being on a living, breathing, competent, intelligent person who is aware of those very weaknesses. So note the weaknesses, but don't fall into the trap of thinking that one chink in the armor negates the entire existence of that armor. So hopefully you guys find that useful, informative, and you can kind of temper that line of reasoning a bit with putting the armor in its intended context and what it's really intended to do. So hopefully I can do more videos in this style in addition to the other videos that I already do. If you guys enjoy that, let me know by giving me a thumbs up if you liked it. Subscribe if you haven't already. And as always, if you have comments or questions, please leave them down below. I always try to get to as many as I possibly can. Feel free to follow me on Facebook and all that stuff. And we will be back soon. Thank you very much for watching.